The story of Jacob's ladder has fascinated people for many years. The expression Jacob's ladder has developed into a common phrase and has been used as the title of a movie, a book, a flower, and even as the name of an electronic device. But where did this phrase come from in the first place? In Genesis 2, the phrase Jacob's ladder is mentioned. Jacob, the future father of the nation of Israel, was on the run from his twin brother Esau. In Genesis 25, we learn that Jacob had tricked his brother Esau into losing his birthright as Isaac's firstborn son. As it turned out, all it took for Esau to give up his inheritance to his little brother was an offer of soup. In Genesis 27, Jacob escalated his strategy once more, assuming the role of Esau to cunningly mislead his elderly and nearly sightless father into bestowing blessings upon him. These deceptions combined transferred to Jacob both the physical and spiritual blessings of the family lineage. Jacob's theft of Esau's blessing and birthright caused tension between him and his older brother. Because of this, the word of God says in Genesis 27 verse 41, "So Esau hated Jacob because of the blessing with which his father blessed him, and Esau said in his heart, 'The days of mourning for my father are very near. Then I will kill my brother Jacob.'" Esau meant every word he spoke. Knowing this, Jacob's mother Rebekah sent Jacob to her brother Laban for refuge. Jacob hoped to find a wife and establish a new life there, safe from his brother's fury, with his father's permission. Genesis 28 verse 5. "Then Isaac sent Jacob away, and he went to Paddan to Laban, the son of Bethuel, the Aramean, the brother of Rebekah, the mother of Jacob and Esau." Jacob decided to camp out under the stars alone and on the run, with nothing but a rock for a cushion. At this time, Jacob's heart was probably filled with regret for the past, loneliness in the present, and uncertainty about the future. But then the story takes a momentous turn. Genesis 28 verses 11 to 22. "And he came to a certain place and stayed overnight there because the sun had set. Taking one of the stones of the place, he put it under his head and lay down there to sleep. He dreamed that there was a ladder, a stairway, placed on the earth, and the top of it reached out of sight toward heaven. He saw the angels of God ascending and descending on it, going to and from heaven. And behold, the Lord stood above and around him, saying, 'I am the Lord, the God of Abraham, your father's father, and the God of Isaac. I will give to you and to your descendants the land of promise on which you are lying. Your descendants shall be as countless as the dust of the earth, and you shall spread abroad to the west, the east, the north, and the south. All the families and nations of the earth shall be blessed through you and your descendants. Behold, I am with you, and will keep careful watch over you, and guard you wherever you may go. I will bring you back to this promised land, for I will not leave you until I have done what I have promised you." Then Jacob awoke from his sleep and said, "Without any doubt, the Lord is in this place, and I did not realize it." So he was afraid and said, "How fearful and awesome is this place! This is none other than the house of God, and this is the gateway to heaven." So Jacob got up early in the morning, took the stone he had put under his head, and set it up as a pillar, a monument to the vision in history. He poured olive oil on the top of it to consecrate it. He named that place Bethel, the house of God. The previous name of that city was Luz, the almond tree. Then Jacob made a vow, a promise, saying, "If God will be with me and will keep me on this journey that I take and will give me food to eat and clothing to wear, and if he grants that I return to my father's house safely, then the Lord will be my God. This stone, which I have set up as a pillar, monument, memorial, will be God's house, a sacred place to me. And of everything that you give me, I will give the tenth to you as an offering, to signify my gratitude and dependence on you." This is Jacob's first supernatural encounter with God, and it parallels Abraham's in Genesis 15. It's also worth noting that Jacob is nearly the same age as Abraham was when God told him to leave his home and travel to a new land. A ladder set up on the ground is more accurately expressed as a ramp or staircase, similar to a mount built against the walled city. Jacob did not simply receive a vision from God. He also acquired a message from God. The word for Jacob confirmed the promise made to Abraham and Isaac, "Your descendants will be like the dust of the earth, and all the peoples of the earth will be blessed through you." This is the first time Jacob has heard God's promise. It wasn't new information, but it became real for him when he realized it was God's promise. When Jacob awoke from his sleep, he knew exactly what had happened. He concluded, "Surely the Lord is in this place, and I did not know it." The place had not changed. It was still the desert with only a rock as a pillow. But God appeared in that place, revealing himself to Jacob in his brokenness and weariness because he needed Jacob to reach the end of himself before relying on God. We know Jacob had a new encounter with God because he was afraid, not of Esau, but of the one true God. A greater fear had driven out a lesser fear because God's power had triumphed over Esau's power. Jacob had dozed off in a certain place, but after seeing God, he awoke and gave the location a sacred name, Bethel. What was once a dark place was transformed into a holy space. Nothing had changed in Jacob's situation. All that had changed was Jacob's new vision of God, and it changed everything. The pagan city of Luz was transformed into Bethel, meaning the house of God. Jacob poured oil on top of the rough pillow stone, transforming it into the cornerstone of a God-centered altar. He sanctified this dark place, invisibly recognizing the supernatural at work right there in the harsh natural world. Even though Jacob had claimed the family line inheritance for himself, God wanted him to understand that, while he was God's chosen heir to fulfill God's promises to Abraham, the plan would be carried out in God's way, not Jacob's. It would be some time before Jacob fully grasped this truth. This is the visual Jacob sees in the dream, but what does it mean? In his encounter with Nathaniel, the Lord Jesus makes an apparent reference to this incident. Nathaniel had met Philip after gaining newfound joy. Eager to share this joy, Philip decided to speak with Nathaniel, keeping his message simple and short. He told Nathaniel that he had found the Messiah, foretold by Moses and the prophets, Jesus of Nazareth. Nathaniel, however, had reservations about Nazareth, a despised city of Galilee. The idea of the Messiah living in such a poor neighborhood seemed impossible to him, prompting him to voice his concerns. Philip, unfazed by the objection, believed the best way to address it was to introduce Nathaniel directly to the Lord Jesus. Jesus, seeing Nathaniel approaching, identified him as a true Israelite, a descendant of Jacob, without guile or deceit. Nathaniel, surprised that a stranger could speak to him as if they had known each other, was acknowledged by Jesus despite being hidden. In John 1 verses 49 to 51, Nathaniel acknowledged Jesus as the Son of God and the King of Israel. Jesus responded, referencing Nathaniel being seen under the fig tree, and assured him that he would witness even greater things. Jesus, using the phrase most assuredly, depicted a future time when he would return to reign over the earth. The imagery included heaven opening, angels ascending and descending on the Son of Man, a bridge between heaven and earth. This statement emphasized the significance of Jesus as the carpenter's son from despised Nazareth, who would be recognized as the true Son of God and King of Israel when he reigns, with Jerusalem as his capital. Nathaniel likely connected this revelation to the story of Jacob's ladder, where ascending and descending angels symbolized Jesus Christ, the only access to heaven. The angels of God would ascend and descend upon the Son of Man, signifying a profound connection between heaven and earth. Jesus informed Nathaniel that he had witnessed only minor demonstrations of his messiahship. In the future reign of Christ, Nathaniel would see the Lord Jesus fully revealed as God's anointed Son. The latter, as illustrated, signifies the relationship between God and man, depicting that the God who created the universe desires a close connection with his creation, especially mankind. It emphasizes that God is the one who initiates this connection, discussion, and friendship. Just as Jacob's ladder illustrated the connection between God and man, Jesus Christ serves as the spiritual connection, mediator, and ladder, bridging the gap created by sin between God and humanity. This role is highlighted in Hebrews 9 verse 15, stating that Jesus is the mediator of the New Testament, providing redemption for transgressions under the First Testament so that those called might receive the promise of eternal inheritance. Jesus Christ, through his sacrifice, initiated a new spiritual covenant that is available to all. He exchanged our sins for his righteousness, enabling us to know God and enjoy the intimate relationship he intended from the start. As affirmed by the Roman soldier at the cross, Jesus was indeed the Son of God. As Christians, we perceive the dream of Jacob's ladder as highly symbolic, representing Jesus Christ as the mediator who came to earth and became the ladder or stairway for us to reconnect the relationship with God that was severed because of sin. Romans 5 verses 1-2. Therefore, since we have been justified, that is, acquitted of sin and declared blameless before God by faith, let us grasp the fact that we have peace with God and the joy of reconciliation with Him through our Lord Jesus Christ, the Messiah, the Anointed. Through Him, we also have access by faith into this remarkable state of grace in which we firmly, safely, and securely stand. Let us rejoice in our hope and the confident assurance of experiencing and enjoying the glory of our great God, the manifestation of His excellence. According to the Word of God, Jesus was our ideal Jacob's ladder who came to earth from the line of Jacob. Through God's provisions, He redeemed us so that we could live in heaven for all eternity. Jacob's reaction to this vision suggests that he may have become a true believer on this occasion. His dream emphasizes God's initiating grace, not because he was righteous, but because of God's call and faithfulness to Abraham. Jacob was the third generation to receive the promises of the Abrahamic covenant. The ladder, more like an escalator in the Hebrew context, was moving, with one ladder ascending and one descending, and angels ascending and descending. When Jacob awoke, he promised God a tenth of everything he created. Looking at the characters in Genesis, parallels to Jesus emerge. Going back to the time when Abraham was told to offer Isaac as a sacrifice, he was directed to a specific mountain known as Moriah. Years later, that same mountain became known as Golgotha, the place where God sacrificed His only Son. In Genesis 3, amid His punishment of Adam and Eve, God made a promise. He told the serpent that the woman's offspring would bruise the serpent's head, as the serpent bruised the offspring's heel. This promise marked the first indication that God would one day deal Satan a fatal blow. The Bible reveals who bound the strong man and ruined his goods. Ultimate victory will come through Christ, the woman's seed. Throughout the Bible, God frequently communicated with people through dreams, providing critical information and directing them in the actions He designed them to take. Today, God speaks to us through His written word, the Bible, containing stories like Jacob's and specific principles for how He wants us to live. He also speaks to us through the Holy Spirit when we pray, listen to sermons and psalms, interact with other believers, and spend time alone with Him. The key is to do the word rather than just read or hear it. The story of Jacob demonstrates that even when we disappoint Him or fail to give Him our complete allegiance, God does not abandon us. He waits for us to surrender our hearts to Him completely.